The Lord be with you, and welcome to our worship service this morning on this, the seventh Sunday of Easter, the final Sunday in the Easter season. Next Sunday will be the celebration of the coming of the Holy Spirit upon the church as we celebrate Pentecost. But for today, one last Easter Sunday. And an Easter Sunday that's a little bit different than the six that have come before, because this past Thursday was the 40th day after Easter, and the day the church remembers that the Lord ascended back again to the throne of the Father. And while that won't be our main focus this morning, the event at least of the ascension, what we are going to be talking about is what Jesus is doing for us right now as our ascended Savior, namely interceding for us, standing by the throne of the Heavenly Father and passing along and praying for us the things that we can't even begin to pray for. And in our gospel reading this morning, which will be the main focus, we will hear one of the prayers of Jesus, prayed right before his crucifixion on the last night that he was together with his disciples, called his high priestly prayer. And that will be our focus in due course in the worship service. So welcome to this seventh Sunday of Easter service, wherever you're tuning us in, or whether it's a couple days afterwards and you're getting a chance to catch up on things on YouTube, welcome. We're happy to have you join with us today. Our order of service is available on the church website. For those of you who are on our email service, it was sent around on Thursday, but over the last couple of Sundays and again today, we will be able to display the liturgy on the screen, so that should help everyone to follow along with the service. Thank you also to Brigetta for our pre-service music this morning, accompanied by Jennifer. We're now going to begin with our opening hymn, a hymn that celebrates our Lord's ascension. Three verses of the hymn, Hymn of Glory, Let Us Sing. If you're using the hymnal at home, it's number 493.
Thank you.
Our order of service this morning is adapted from Divine Service Setting 1 in the Lutheran Service Book. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let's take a moment and reflect upon God's word and take some time to examine our own hearts and our own lives. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. The mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ, was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us for all of our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. May the Lord, who has begun this good work in us, bring it to completion in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, wherever they may be, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Amen.
Amen.
And now, wherever you are this morning, the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O King of glory, Lord of hosts, uplifted in triumph far above all heavens, leave us not without consolation or comfort, but we pray you to send us the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth, whom you promised from the Father. For you live and you reign with him and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Turn our attention now to the scripture readings for the seventh Sunday of Easter. Our first reading comes from the Acts of the Apostles in chapter 1. We're going to begin reading at verse 12. The first 12 verses of the book of Acts are the account of Jesus' ascension into heaven again, which, as I said, occurred 40 days after Easter and was observed by the church this past Thursday. The disciples didn't waste any time after Jesus ascended. They were told to be witnesses, and they were told to get out and do the work that they had been called to do. And so one of the first tasks that they were given was the task of replacing Judas, who had betrayed Jesus to restore the number of the apostles back up to 12. And so St. Luke, as he writes the Acts of the Apostles, gives us a detailed account of how Matthias was chosen to be one of the apostles. Then the apostles returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey away. When they had entered, they went up to the upper room where they were staying, Peter and John and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas the son of James. All these, with one accord, were devoting themselves to prayer, together with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brothers. In those days, Peter stood up among the brothers. The company of persons was in all about 120. And he said, "Brothers, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit spoke about beforehand by the mouth of David concerning Judas, who became a guide to those who arrested Jesus. For he was numbered among us and was allotted his share in this ministry." Now this man had bought a field with the reward of his wickedness, and falling headlong, he burst open in the middle and all his bowels gushed out. And it became known to all of the inhabitants of Jerusalem as the field, so that the field was called in their own language, Akeldama. Well, that means field of blood. For it is written in the book of Psalms, "May his camp be desolate, and let there be no one to dwell in it, and let another take his office." So one of the men who have accompanied us during all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John until the day he was taken up from us, one of these men must become with us a witness to his resurrection. And they put forward two: Joseph, called Barsabbas, who was also called Justus, and Matthias. And they prayed and said, "You, Lord, know the hearts of all. Show which one of these two you have chosen to place in this ministry and apostleship from which Judas turned aside to go to his own place." And they cast lots for them, and the lot fell to Matthias, and he was numbered with the 11 apostles. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our second reading this morning comes from the fourth and fifth chapters of the first letter of Peter. We've been reading through 1 Peter during this Easter season, and Peter here talks very candidly to the early Christians about the trials that will come upon them and the struggles that they will have and the faithfulness that is required, not just of the first apostles, but even you and me yet today. Begin reading in chapter 4, verse 12. "Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery trial when it comes upon you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice insofar as you share Christ's sufferings, that you may also rejoice and be glad when his glory is revealed. If you are insulted for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you. Let none of you suffer as a murderer or a thief or an evildoer or as a meddler. Yet if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in that name. For it is time for judgment to begin at the household of God. And if it begins with us, what will be the outcome for those who do not obey the gospel of God? And if the righteous is scarcely saved, what will become of the ungodly and the sinner? Therefore, let those who suffer according to God's will entrust their souls to a faithful Creator while doing good. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time He may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on Him, because He cares for you. Be sober-minded. Be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Resist him, firm in your faith, knowing that the same kinds of suffering are being experienced by your brotherhood throughout the world. And after you have suffered a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. To him be the dominion forever and ever. Amen. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We're going to listen to an anthem now. Judy Lumsden is going to sing for us. The song is called My Redeemer.
As I look back on this road I've traveled, I've seen so many times He's carried me through. And if there is one thing that I've learned in this life, my Redeemer is faithful and true. My Redeemer is faithful and true, and everything that He has said He will do, and every morning His mercies are new. My Redeemer is faithful and true. My heart rejoices when I read His promise. There is a place that He's preparing for me. I know that one day I'll see my Lord face to face, 'cause my Redeemer is faithful and true. My Redeemer is faithful and true, and everything that He has said He do, and every morning His mercies are new. My Redeemer is faithful and true, and in every situation He has proved His love for me. When I lack the understanding, He gives more grace to me. My Redeemer is faithful and true, and everything that He has said He will do, and every morning His mercies are new. My Redeemer is faithful and true. He's so true. My Redeemer is faithful and
the Holy Gospel according to St. John in the 17th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. When Jesus had spoken these words, he lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that the Son may glorify you. Since you have given him authority over all flesh, to give eternal life to all whom you have given to him. And this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth, having accomplished the work you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory I had with you before the world existed. I have manifested your name to your people, whom you gave me out of the world. Yours they were, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know everything that you have given me is from you, for I have given them the words you gave me, and they have received them and have come to know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I am praying for them. And I'm not praying for the world, but for those whom you have given me, for they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I am glorified in them. I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, keep them in your name, which you have given me, that they may be one, even as we are one. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Our next hymn is the first three verses of the song, Alleluia, Sing to Jesus. If you're following along in a hymnal at home, it's number 821.
Jesus, he has stepped in his
To each and every one of you, wherever you may be, God's grace and mercy and peace through our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ. We are going to focus our attention this morning on the gospel reading, the opening paragraphs of Jesus' high priestly prayer for his disciples. I'm just going to read to you a little bit from the beginning of the second paragraph of that reading, John chapter 17, verse 6, and then also a little bit from verse 11. Jesus prays, and he says, "I have manifested your name to the people whom you gave me out of the world." And then at the very end of what was our reading this morning, Jesus prays, "I'm no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you, Holy Father. Keep them in your name, which you have given me, that they may be one, even as we are one." I don't know about you, but one of the hardest things for me in these recent days has been to kind of know what's really true. So many bits of conflicting information here, there, and everywhere about COVID-19, about the coronavirus, about what are the right things to do to prevent the spread of the virus, and what are the, you know, when can we expect things to reopen again. I'll give you just one example of something that I saw this past week. We all heard our national director of health tell us this week that as the economy reopens and we venture out to stores and other places again, that we should carry a mask with us. And if we find ourselves in a situation where it's difficult to be physically distant from other people, we should have that mask ready and on our faces so that we avoid the passing along of the coronavirus and making people ill. It all seems like pretty good information, pretty easy to follow, and medically pretty sound. But then later, the very same day that we heard those words, I was going through one of my social media accounts, and a person that I know posted a picture of a man who had been working on some drywall and sanding that drywall. And this man had a mask covering his nose and his mouth, a type of mask that I see many people wearing around town these days, and held on seemingly rather tightly by an elastic band around his head. And his face is covered in drywall dust, and anybody who's ever worked with drywall knows that's exactly what happens to you. And in the first frame, he's there with his dusty face and his drywall mask on. And then in the second frame, he removes the mask, and there you see under the mask about the same amount of drywall dust as is on the rest of his face. And obviously, the caption under the picture says, you know, if drywall dust, which you can see, makes it through the mask, what about the virus you can't see? Now, I'm not for half a minute, and please don't take this as I'm endorsing what this person put online. I only raise it as a kind of an illustration of how difficult it can be in this world these days to know exactly what to believe. We heard the words of our chief medical officer, and yet someone else presents some anecdotal evidence of a guy in a drywall mask and the mess he is and how much of this he must have inhaled, and on it goes. And in a spiritual way, it makes it hard even to know what to pray for. I've noticed this myself in recent days, that it's getting harder to know just exactly how to shape my own prayers as I think about the world that we're living in today. You know, do we pray that the economy would open up again quickly? Do we pray that, you know, we could get back to doing what we usually do here at Holy Cross as quickly as possible? Or is that somehow contradictory with praying that as few people as possible are afflicted with this virus? us. It's really difficult to know exactly how to frame our prayers, and then it gets more complicated when nobody really knows what exactly is true. Now, none of this really probably should surprise us. It's an old saying is that one of the first casualties in any war is the truth, and we are in a war of sorts, and truth is going to be distorted by all kinds of people for their own ends, and you know that the one who prowls about like a roaring lion that we heard about in our epistle reading this morning, the evil one himself, is out there distorting truths left, right, and center. He doesn't care whether he distorts the medical truth or he doesn't care whether somebody spouts a lie on the internet. He's there fanning the flames of doubt and wonder and spreading his own misinformation. So what can we hold on to? What is true? Well, let me tell you something. The scripture passage that I have found increasingly comforting in the last little while. It's not one of our readings for today, but you'll see pretty quickly a connection. It's from Romans chapter 8, that famous chapter that talks about us being more than conquerors through Christ who loved us. And I'm just going to read to you a little bit, skip around some verses in Romans 8, beginning at verse 31. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who is indeed interceding for us. Stop and chew on that last phrase for just a half a second. In this world, where it's hard right now to know what's right, what's true, what we should do and what we should not do, in this world where sometimes it's very hard even to know what to pray for, here's something you can hang on to. That even if your own prayers are failing, the Lord Jesus Christ himself, the same Jesus who died on the cross, the same Jesus who rose again from the dead, is now ascended into heaven. And what's he doing up there? He's praying. He's praying for you and for me. And in this morning's gospel, we got to see one of Jesus' prayers, a prayer specifically framed for the time when he would no longer visibly be present with his disciples. And we get to see right into his heart. What are the things that Jesus prays for his disciples? He begins, the 17th chapter begins with Jesus praying for himself, and praying that he would be glorified in the things that were about to happen to him. And what was about to happen to him was he was about to die on the cross. This is the very end of Jesus meeting with his disciples in the upper room, and presumably as they walked along the way to the Garden of Gethsemane, this is his prayer for them that they overheard and that John was inspired to faithfully record. And it begins, as I said, with Jesus praying that he would be glorified by his death and by his resurrection, and that the Father would be glorified. And then he turns his attention to his disciples. And he says this about his disciples. I have manifested your name to the people whom you have given me out of the world. I have manifested your name. That sounds kind of abstract, and you might wonder, what's he really saying there? Well, it's a wonderful promise It's actually a wonderful summary of all of Jesus' earthly ministry, particularly as it is recorded in John's gospel. Because one of the big things that Jesus has done throughout this gospel has unpacked for us the meaning of God's name. If you remember way back in the book of Exodus, when Moses was sent to Pharaoh to lead the people out of Egypt, one of the things he wanted to know from God was God's name. He didn't need that so much for Pharaoh. Pharaoh couldn't care less what God's name was, but he knew he needed it for the people of Israel. They weren't going to believe him unless he could tell them what God's name was. And so you remember what God said to Moses. He said, "My name is this. I am who I am. I will be who I will be." Now that's kind of abstract. A little difficult to explain. But Jesus' ministry has been all about explaining that name and unpacking that name for his disciples. And as I said a few moments ago, John in particular is the one who conveys a lot of that teaching. Over and over again in his gospel, John records Jesus using sentences that begin with, "I am." For example, in John chapter 6, he says, "I am the bread of life." There he's saying, I am. He's taking God's name, I am, and unpacking that name for us, revealing that name for us as being the one who provides us with our spiritual food. Just as God provided manna to the people of Israel in the wilderness as they journeyed from Egypt to their promised land, so also our God feeds us through his word at his table with the very body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, that we might feast upon him and there find our strength in this world. We're in John chapter 8. "I am the light of the world." There, the God who at the very beginning said, "Let there be light," has now come into this world to be light, to shine the light upon our path through his word, so that we can go in the times when there is great darkness all around us and know the way. Or, "I am the gate." Pastor Sines, in his farewell sermon, reminded us of what the meaning of that is, that a good shepherd would lay down at night in the opening, in the place where you and I would put a gate today to keep the sheep safe. He'd put himself between the sheep and that which would harm them. He is the gate who protects his sheep. And again, he invokes God's name, "I am the gate." Or a little later in that same chapter, John chapter 10, "I am the good shepherd." The good shepherd who lays down his life for the sheep, who's not just going to take off when trouble comes, but who's actually really going to lay down his life for you and for me so that we will have life and have it abundantly. Or as we heard just before Easter, when Jesus comes to the tomb of Lazarus and death seems to have won, there's no light, there's no joy, there's no happiness at all. He says, "I'm the resurrection and the life." God's name is life and resurrection. And at the end, it's God's name that will be raised above all other names. Or as we heard just a couple of weeks ago in John chapter 14, where Jesus is comforting his disciples about his time when he will leave them, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father by me." In all of these situations, Jesus is taking that divine name and he is revealing that name to you and to me, manifesting that name. Because it's a little hard to get your mind around, I am who I am, or I will be who I will be. But we know about bread, and we know about light, and we know about gates and shepherds and paths, and we know about resurrection and life, even if we've never experienced it. And in John chapter 15, there's one more, I'm the vine. Stay connected to me and I to you, and will bear much fruit. In each and every case, he's manifesting God's name to you and me, telling us the truth about God's name, comforting us with that, so that in the midst of all of the confusion and in the midst of all of the things that we don't understand, we might know for truth that we have bread and we have light and we have a protecting shepherd and a conquering savior, one who shows us the way and who joins us to himself as the vine. Now, all of this is going to get Jesus into a whole pack of trouble. In fact, it already has. The Jewish leaders of his time, they know exactly what he's doing. They know he's using God's name. And to their ears, he's using God's name in vain. You may even remember one time what happened to Jesus in John chapter 8 when he had the audacity to stand before the leaders and say, "Before Abraham was, I am." And what did they want to do? They wanted to stone him. But no matter how much those words riled up the people back then, they are great comfort for you and me today. That's what he has manifested to you and to me. That's been the whole sum and substance of his earthly ministry, unpacking the name of God for you and for me. Why? Because when we were baptized into that name. We were baptized into the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And that's, again, a kind of an abstract thing. What does that mean? What does it mean to say that? Well, it means to say that in that act of baptism, he became your food. He became your way. He became your shepherd. He became your resurrection and life. And he joins you now to him as the vine. And where that name is, there is truth. Jesus makes the connection for us a couple verses later. He says, "I have given them the words that you gave me, and they have received them, and they have come to know the truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me." Where God's name is, God is. And where God is, truth is. And for you and for me today, that truth comes in his word. We are for a time unable to gather together as people here in this church and draw strength from one another in our common witness to the faith. We are tragically also unable to come to the Lord's altar as a congregation and to receive his body and his blood together in a communion with him and with each other. And what that does for you and me, on one hand, it makes us very sad. But where do we go? And we go to the Word. Because the Word is at the thing that is at the root of it all. Your baptism has power, not because of the pastor who baptized you or the water that was used. Communion has power, not because of the kind of bread we use or the wine that we drink, but because of God's Word coming to you and to me. And it's that same Word that we have in our homes and in our scriptures. And even though I say sometimes my own prayer life is struggling a little bit, as I don't know exactly just how to put all this into words and how to bring this all before God in some sort of semi-coherent fashion, that doesn't have to be my main concern. My main concern is to really to listen to him in his word. And if you haven't already done so, I encourage you to, for example, take a walk through the book of Psalms these days. And some of the things that maybe seem kind of abstract in ordinary times when life is going on as normal suddenly take on a new urgency, a new vibrancy. We know right now what it's like to be oppressed a little bit. We know right now what it's like to have an enemy, even though we can't really see it. We know right now what it's like to be in a time of struggle and lament. And there you'll find words, true words, to pray. In a certain sense, the very best prayers that we pray aren't the ones that we just kind of make up and mumble our way through, but are like Jesus' prayer here, which is really just a meditation on what God has said in a number of other places in the Scripture. It's saying back to God what God has already said to us. And that's exactly what we do when we pray the Lord's Prayer. These very words that Jesus prays for us, I have manifested your name to your people. We pray the very same thing. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. May that name and all that it means and all that it stands for be holy in my life. It's holy all in and of itself, as Luther tells us in the Catechism, but we're praying here that it would be holy in my life. That I would know that he's my good shepherd, that he's the light, he's the bread, he's all those things. And so his prayer, the thing he's praying for you and for me, when we maybe can't even put together too many coherent thoughts ourselves, what's he praying? Well, keep them in your name, he prays. I am coming to you, Holy Father. And as he stands there at the right hand of the throne of our Heavenly Father, he's there interceding for you and for me. Keep them in your name. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now may the great peace of God, which passes all our human understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in true faith to life everlasting. We're going to join now to confess the Apostles' Creed, which is based on the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, where we confess what we believe and has been made known to us by the Holy Scriptures. I invite you to join in wherever you are as we confess this creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. In many and various ways, God's people have continued to bring forth their offerings as a tithe and as a thank you to the Lord for his benefits and for the proclamation of the gospel. We take some of those each week and we place them in the offering plate and present them before the Lord on behalf of all of the others. We give you but your own in any gift we bring. All that we have is yours alone, a trust from you, our King. We now come to a time of prayer, And I invite you to follow along with the prayers at home. They will not be printed on your screen. But at the end of each petition, you will hear the words, "Lord, in your mercy." And I invite you to respond by saying, "Hear our prayer." We've been asked to remember two people from our congregation in our prayers this morning. One is Donna Sauter, who was in the hospital for a few days this week, but is now home and continuing her recovery there, not COVID-19 related. And also Carol Lautenschlager, who's at Freeport for some rehabilitation, again, not related to COVID, but her family have also asked us to keep her in our prayers. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Lord God, you have promised not to abandon your people, but to be with us always. Grant us grace to hear your word with faith. Give us courage that we may give bold witness to the truth in our own day and proclaim Jesus Christ to the ends of the earth. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, you have promised to us your Holy Spirit, and you always promise to supply your church with pastors and teachers who will preach and teach your word. Be especially with those of our seminaries who will be assigned their first calls later this week. Raise up those who will serve our church in generations to come, that we may never be without the aid of those who serve us in your name. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, you send your light, your Son, to be light to the nations. Send out messengers and missionaries to every corner of the earth, that from every tribe, nation, and language would know the saving light of the world, your Son, Jesus Christ. Bless especially the missions of our synod in Ukraine, in Central America, and in Southeast Asia. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, you have power over all things, and appoint an order on earth for the protection of the weak, the punishment of evildoers, and the encouragement of virtue. Bless all who make, administer, and judge our laws. Give them wisdom for the peculiar and unique challenges of this time, and preserve them from self-serving concerns. Give us grace that we might honor the gift of peace and order and good government, and be good citizens and neighbors to all. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And Lord God, you have compassion upon all who suffer. Give grace to the sick, to those with mental illness, to the dying in their last hours, and to those who grieve. Hear us especially for Donna Sauter, who was in hospital this past week and who now recovers at home, and also for Carol Lautenschlager, who is in Freeport for rehabilitation. Be with those that we all name in our hearts before you. Grant them patience in their afflictions. Deliver them according to your gracious will. And Lord God, we also ask that you would be with the doctors, nurses, and all other healthcare professionals who minister to the needs of your people, especially in this global pandemic. Through their wise and compassionate service, grant relief to the suffering and hope to the afflicted, so that all may know your boundless care through Jesus Christ our Lord. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And finally, Lord, we rejoice in the Savior's promise to guard your people who wear your name by baptism and faith. Until we are with you in your presence forevermore, guard us against the devil who prowls about like a roaring lion seeking those whom he might devour. Grant us the power to resist him and to trust you without fear. Keep us in your name. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And we join together to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now receive the benediction of the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Again, welcome to all of you who have joined us this morning. It's very good to have you with us, or if you've tuned in a little bit later in the week, welcome to you as well. We don't have a whole host of parish announcements this week, except to invite you to continue strong in your prayers that God's will be done. A reminder that if there's any spiritual need that you have, or you would like to receive the Lord's Supper in a private communion service, you're more than welcome to get in touch with me and we can make those arrangements. Also, Lenora is back at work this week, working from home, but back in town again. And she has a number of small groups scheduled for this week. And if you would like to join one of those, there was an email sent out a few days ago listing the times. Until we gather together again next week, may God bless and keep you. We're going to close our service with four verses of the hymn, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name. It's number 549 in the hymnal. We'll sing verse 1, then verses 3 and 4, and then verse 6.